it did feel like waking up from the Matrix. It felt like you thought the world was one way, and then in just an instant, you realize that there's something happening that most people know nothing about.
Behind almost every ecosystem on Earth, there's a whole world of parasites pulling the strings. They can mind control their hosts, causing mice to seek out the smell of cat pee. They can shapeshift their hosts, physically changing them to look like food. And their ripple effects can reshape entire landscapes.
They are just puppet masters behind the scenes, holding the strings of everything you thought had free will.
For centuries, people have thought of parasites as nature's villains. They often infect people and livestock. In fact, parasites are by definition bad for their hosts. But today, more and more scientists are starting to look at parasites as a force for good. Chelsea Wood is one of those scientists. She's a parasite ecologist, a job she never expected to have.
I don't think anyone is born a parasitologist. Like, no one grows up wanting to study worms. Somewhere along the way, I fell in love with them. I couldn't believe that I'd gotten that far in my biology education. And no one had ever mentioned to me that parasites are incredibly biodiverse, ubiquitous, everywhere.
Chelsea brought me to this beach in Washington State to show me one way that parasites can actually be good. Back in the 1960s, one of Chelsea's mentors had sampled crabs from this very beach.
This beach was much more industrial back in the late 60s and early 70s. It was, you know, much, much more polluted.
Recently, the two of them returned to see what had changed half a century later. And things looked completely different. The beach was cleaner, the shorebirds had returned, and the crabs were full of parasites. They were trematode worms, a type of parasite that jumps between crabs and birds. Chelsea told me parasites were a sign that the shorebirds were actually doing great.
Parasites are a bellwether. They're a way for us to know what's happening in the rest of the ecosystem.
Look at how pretty she is.
So if the parasites are there, you know that the rest of the hosts are there as well. And in that way, they can sort of be a signal about the health of the ecosystem.
As scientists have learned more and more about this strange wormy world, some have argued that many ecosystems might actually need parasites in order to thrive. To understand this counterintuitive idea, it's helpful to look at another class of animals that people also used to hate, predators. All around the country, people used to hunt and kill predators like wolves, bears, coyotes, and cougars. But eventually, some people started noticing some major consequences. And nowhere was that more apparent than in Yellowstone.
In Yellowstone, gray wolves were totally eradicated from the park in the 1920s. And that was systematic persecution. People went out and hunted them down and shot them. But once they did, things changed in Yellowstone.
Without wolves, herds of elk grew unchecked, overgrazing near streams and rivers, and eventually driving away all the native beavers. Soon, ponds disappeared and the water table dropped. Before long, the entire landscape had changed.
It was a real problem for Yellowstone for many years, until the reintroduction of gray wolves in the 1990s. When those wolves came back in, it was like a wave of green rolled over Yellowstone.
This story became one of the defining parables in ecology. In Yellowstone and beyond, scientists started to realize that predators weren't just killers. They were actually holding entire ecosystems together.
You know, there's a lot of parallels between predator ecology and parasite ecology.
Like the gray wolves in Yellowstone, scientists are just starting to recognize the profound ways that ecosystems are shaped by parasites. Like this, the nematomorph worm. These worms are born in the water, but spend their lives on land inside of bugs. This worm right here came out of this spider. At the end of its life, the worm needs to move back to the water to mate. And instead of making the dangerous journey itself, it tricks its infected host into giving it a ride.
And the way it does this is inducing what's called a water drive. It's basically this suicidal impulse to drown itself in water. And that insect will move to the edge of the water, consider it for a little while, and then jump in to its own death, but to this parasite's benefit.
The story doesn't end there. Fish eat the bugs that throw themselves in the water, and one species of endangered trout gets 60% of its diet exclusively from these infected bugs.
So essentially, the parasite is feeding this endangered trout population.
Without the threat of hungry fish, the native insects in the stream end up eating all the algae, giving the creek clear water. Essentially, this entire creek ecosystem relies on a worm trying to hitch a ride to the water.
These parasites are literally keeping these ecosystems afloat.
Parasites make up an estimated 40% of the animal kingdom. Yet scientists know next to nothing about millions of these parasite species around the world. Really, the only parasites that scientists have spent a lot of time studying are the ones that infect farm animals, pets, and people.
Cases of what's called CRS, tripling.
Cases of tick-borne diseases are rising.
There's this general sense that infection is on the rise, that parasites and other infectious organisms are more common than they used to be.
Fungal infections linked to climate change.
Why are these ticks moving?
Probably due to climate change.
Climate change seems to be spreading because we think of global warming.
Turns out that, at least for wildlife parasites, there really aren't long-term data to tell us whether that impression that we have is real. We had to invent a way to get those data.
For Chelsea, she found those answers here, in a museum basement.
You know, so much has been discovered from museum specimens that we tucked away at one time and then pulled off the shelf 100 years later.
These jars are full of preserved fishes dating all the way back to the 1800s.
These are weird.
Yeah, they are.
But they also contain something else. All the parasites that were living inside the fish samples. In other words, hidden inside this subterranean basement is a 140-year parasite record.
It's really remarkable to get to peer back in time the way that you do when you open up a fish from 100 years ago. It's the only way that we'll know anything about what the oceans were like parasitologically that long ago.
Chelsea and her team spent over 2 years opening up jars and surgically dissecting the parasites from within. Under microscopes, they'd identify and count the parasites, and then they'd return everything back to the jars for future use. They repeated this hundreds of times, finding more than 17,000 parasites. When they charted everything, they found a mix of winners and losers, but there was one big class of parasites that was unequivocally declining. Complex parasites, the kinds that need several different host species to survive. Those parasites declined an average of 10% each decade. In many ways, it makes sense that these complex parasites would be more at risk. They can only survive if every one of their host species are around. If just one type of host goes missing,
game over. That's it for that parasite. That's why we think that these complex life cycle parasites are so vulnerable, because things are shifting, and the more points of failure you have, the likelier you are to fail.
In her investigation, there was only one factor that perfectly explained the decline in parasites. It wasn't chemicals or overfishing. It was climate change. And this was a big deal. It was a sign that our warming climate could be wiping out this important class of parasites.
It's likely a collateral impact of climate change that we had no idea about before the study was done. We don't even have a handle on how many parasites there are in the world, much less the scale of parasite biodiversity loss right now. But the early indications are that parasites are at least as vulnerable as their hosts, and potentially more vulnerable.
Parasites play huge and complex roles in nature. And if we ignore what we can't see, we're missing out on understanding how the world really works.
We all have a reflexive distaste for parasites, right? Like, they're gross, right? You take drugs, we apply chemicals, we spray. They're meant to be eradicated by people. Our argument is that parasites are just species, right? They're part of biodiversity, and they're doing really important things in ecosystems that we depend upon them for. We need them, even though they look gross and slimy. We need them in ecosystems.